Everything's a bit brighter. Everything's a bit clearer. Everything is easier to deal with when I'm with you. I don't need pills or plastic. It's all fantastic when you turn on the light in my mind. When you turn on the light, turn on the light. When you turn on.
Hello, my name is George Kappas, and I'm the director of the Hypnosis Motivation Institute, or HMI, in Tarzana, California, America's first nationally accredited college of hypnotherapy. Founded as a nonprofit organization in 1968 by my father and uncle, Drs. John and Alex Kappas, HMI has been our family's mission and purpose for more than 45 years. I did my first hypnosis demonstration here when I was only 9 years old. Students from all over the world come to HMI to receive professional training and clinical internship. If you tuned in today hoping to see people cluck like chickens, then you've got the wrong show. But stay tuned, and we'll show you how real people are using hypnosis and the power of the subconscious mind to accomplish their goals and achieve their dreams. This is Hypnotized.
My name is Joe Batarsi, and I'm going to be 58 this year. I have a condition called tinnitus.
My name is Catherine Arcet. I'm 57 years old, and I have the condition called tinnitus.
I had noticed a whining pitch noise emanating from my ears.
It was a low tone, and I became terrified. I tensed so bad. I clenched my whole body, waiting for it to go away.
I've noticed an increase in the condition, and particularly the last 2 or 3 years have been a significant degradation of my ability to hear.
It was a very terrifying moment because I didn't know what to do. I was so frightened that it would come back.
I mean, I've gone to a psychologist, psychiatrist, ear, nose, and throat specialist. I've gone to a neurologist, and all the tests that they've conducted have come back negative.
It was quite frustrating because they could find no reason. There's no tumors, there's no blockages, there's nothing.
And they've told me that there's nothing wrong with me, but apparently they can't resolve the issue of the ringing of the ears.
I'm thinking, what if it gets louder? And what if it gets so loud? What if it gets so loud that I can't hear the birds and the wind and even the cars outside and my cat's meow? What's gonna happen to me if I can't hear that anymore? I don't know what to do.
Imagine waking up one day with a strange buzzing sound in your ears that lasts for hours. A week later, it starts again. This time it's louder and happening on and off all day. By the third week, it becomes unbearable, nearly constant. You can't concentrate. It's hard to talk to people, watch TV, or enjoy music. It disrupts your sleep, your relationships, and for some, makes them wonder if life is even worth living under these conditions. What is this chronic ringing in the ears? It's a condition called tinnitus. And the American Tinnitus Association estimates that over 50 million Americans suffer from it. 12 million of them have it bad enough to seek medical attention. Most of those, however, will be medically untreatable and sent home and told, live with it. But what they're not told is how to live with it. We had one client report to us that he spent over $1 million of his own money seeking any and all medical treatments around the world, looking to escape the misery of tinnitus, and despite those efforts, experienced no relief at all. But what if there was a better solution? Something natural, organic, and right inside our own minds. In this episode of Hypnotize, we're going to meet two clients who decided to try hypnosis after all the medical treatments had failed to relieve the suffering of the chronic ringing in their ears. For our hypnotherapist, we're going to once again turn to HMI instructor, John Melton. His professional and personal experience in this area makes him the perfect candidate to demonstrate to our students and you how hypnosis and the power of the mind might be a better solution for those suffering from tinnitus. Hey, John, come on in.
Thanks.
Well, you're probably wondering why we called you here today.
Yes. Do I still have a job?
Well, that depends on what happens in the next 6 weeks.
Okay.
Rose here came to us with a very unusual couple of people that we think will make great examples for the class. Two people came in within a week of each other with the same problem, something we've never done in class before, and I think it's going to interest you. Rose, what is it?
Ringing in the ears.
Ringing in the ears.
I know about that.
Yes, and it is called?
Tinnitus.
Tinnitus. So you personally had some issues with this. Is this
oh, yes.
Yeah, tell us about that.
Since about 1990, probably because of noise exposure, I've dealt with this constant sound that a lot of people get stuck with hearing this, and it can be extremely upsetting. But there's a whole range in terms of how upsetting the condition can be for people. So over time, I adapted to it, and I sought a treatment for it and found there really was not much available out there. So over time, I developed a means of helping people that were more severely disturbed by it.
Okay, so great. So we have a great chance to test that out. In fact, both of these folks, Joe and Kathy, they've tried some things before they got here, correct?
I believe so. But boy, they couldn't be two different type of people. They're two different people when I talk to them.
Right.
For instance, Joe is kind of matter of fact, very calm, very scientific, whereas Kathy, she's more emotional, she's artistic, metaphysical. So they couldn't be two more different people.
Well, that'll be good for demonstration purposes.
Absolutely. It's great. And it really shows that, I mean, type of person, this condition does not discriminate. You know, people of all walks of life deal with it.
Okay. You were saying that you needed it to be, a certain severity level?
So with tinnitus, it really depends on how much it's bothering them. Some people, it bothers them a lot, and those are the people that I can help. Others have adapted to it, and there's really not a lot that I can do to help beyond that.
So the more severe, the better prospect they are for hypnotherapy.
That's true.
And so, how are they?
Well, they both said that it's really severely interfering with their life, especially Kathy. In fact, she cried over the phone when I was speaking with her. Mm-hmm. She cried, so she's definitely affected by this. It's interrupting with her life.
Yeah, when the emotion is that close to the surface and it's easily triggered, it's a good indication that this is someone who needs some help.
Well, if that's the case, and this is a great example to show to the students about how hypnotherapy can help with the millions of people that are out there, and we've got 6 weeks to do it. Let's see what you can do for Joe and Kathy and see if we can't get them living happy, healthy lives again.
It's some of the most wonderful work that I do is helping people with this, because oftentimes they can't find help.
Okay. All right. Well, let's do it.
Okay. Welcome back to the Hypnosis Motivation Institute case history series. We're working with two clients for a condition called tinnitus, and we're going to have our second client come in. His name is Joe.
Okay, well, I've had this condition for a long spell. It's become more significant within the last 10 years, but really, really started to affect my quality of life the last 5 years or so.
When I initially walked into the classroom, I thought it was going to be much more intimate with maybe a couple, three students in there. Felt like I was on late night TV, and there were a lot more people there than I had expected. John really made me feel comfortable, and I really felt he created a very intimate environment for me at that point in time.
Hi, Kathy.
Hi.
Thanks for coming tonight. I'm John, as you know.
When I first went into the classroom, everything seemed big. My eyes sort of went, got bigger. Everyone seemed really professional, but caring at the same time, and I really appreciated that.
Any hope of success for Joe and Kathy is going to depend on John's ability to discover the emotions and unresolved issues that are aggravating their tinnitus symptoms.
We'd like to start tonight just by, if you could just give us a little description of what you've been dealing with this tinnitus, how it's just a kind of a general idea about it.
Well, it's a sound that's like whistling, and sometimes noise bounces inside, mm-hmm. and I'm very sensitive to all kinds of sounds.
Mm-hmm.
There was a point in my life where it wouldn't go away.
Yeah. And how long is it ago did this come up for you? How long?
It's been 20 years.
Previously, I was always able to ignore it,
yeah.
or escape it.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow or other, I've lost that ability now with the volume of noise that seems to be persistent. I can tell you that it's very high pitched, and the pitch has become much more pronounced. And it seems to somehow or other better able to pierce the ambient noise mm-hmm. much more readily now than at any time in the past.
Okay.
When I go to sleep now mm-hmm. and it's present, I get afraid that it's going to get louder and louder, and mm-hmm. I won't be able to hear it. The fear, the great fear, is that it fills the ears, it fills me
right.
up,
uh-huh.
because it feels like it takes up space.
Right.
And I don't want to lose the ability. Okay. I'm sorry.
It's all right. It's okay.
To hear the silence
mm-hmm.
and to hear the wind
right.
and to hear birds sing. And
well, we're going to help you with that,
things
okay?
Things like that. Thank you.
I'm going to help you with that.
Thank you.
Okay. As a former tinnitus sufferer myself, I could completely empathize with Joe and Kathy's concerns about their symptoms. We have something called a SUD scale, a discomfort scale, basically. And if we set that between 0 and 10, 10 meaning just incredibly bad and 0 mm-hmm. meaning not at all, where would you say it is right now?
About a 7.
About a 7.
Mm-hmm. 7.
About a 7.
I can't sleep.
Tell me a little bit about your retirement. Was that something that you wanted, or did it happen at a time when you weren't quite ready for it? Or you seem like a pretty young guy to be retired. I'm jealous. That's why I'm asking.
That started young. Well, it was actually a meeting of the perfect storm. My daughter was showing some behavioral issues,
mm-hmm.
and she was diagnosed with dyslexia, severe dyslexia at that
mm-hmm.
time.
Mm-hmm.
She needed extra attention, and I happened to be in the position where I had enough time in my job
mm-hmm.
that I could actually, you know, bow out
mm-hmm.
at my time, at my convenience,
mm-hmm.
and I exercised that prerogative because I thought the needs of my daughter were so compelling that it forced me to do so.
Yeah, okay. You know, that could be a really stressful time when you're, especially your child has an issue that comes up like this and,
mm-hmm.
you know, trying to figure out how to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
As they're learning, and as I know so well, having done this for so many years, mm-hmm. that this is the kind of thing that often is the precursor to this condition becoming more of an issue.
I'm a trained garden designer, and my business went bust. I've become small.
Mm-hmm. Kind of in life in general, yeah. And so what I take from that is you've kind of withdrawn from things and, yeah.
I'm looking to expand myself into the artistic painting and writing, and that I find is quite scary and painful for me to contemplate, but I think I have a gift.
So all sounds are actually generated in your brain the same way all feelings are generated in your brain as well. And when I was dealing with this condition within myself and looking for a treatment for this, the real moment when I recognized there's something I could do about this was the moment I recognized this was very similar to something called phantom limb pain. And this is where someone can lose maybe their arm and yet they still feel the pain, but the arm's not there. With phantom limb pain and this, it's the same kind of thing. The brain is continuing to create this sound. So one of the really pioneers in understanding this condition was a doctor named Dr. Jastreboff. And he developed a model of this, and he calls this an emotional brain phenomenon. And so there's a recognition that this is something that's going on inside, and it's really tied into these emotional parts of your brain, and especially those of us who are either sensitized in the moment when it really is present or comes on in a certain manner, it sometimes gets stuck.
So
what's happened in your mind is your mind has, your brain has associated this as a threat, even though it's not. And of course, the fear that you associate to it reinforces that cycle. A big part of your life was changing. You were losing your business. It was coming apart. You were stressed. You've probably been chronically stressed coming up into that, dealing
yes.
with that.
Yes.
And then here's the sound. And the sound, because you're hypersensitized at the moment, you grab onto it. And, oh my goodness, what if this doesn't go away? What if this is sound? And then you get caught in this recursive loop. So we're going to work on creating a change in the way you relate to the sound.
John and I talked about what tinnitus really is, and tinnitus is not in the ears, it's in the mind. I didn't know that.
He was able to make me feel or get in touch with what it is that I'm dealing with specifically with tinnitus, how it was impacting me, and made me really examine it at a different level.
Helping Joe and Kathy understand and more importantly accept the connection between their emotional stress and the tinnitus symptoms will be their first step in their recovery from the crippling effects of the sounds in their head.
You know, I've gone to a psychologist, psychiatrist, ear, nose, and throat specialist. I've gone to a neurologist, and all the tests that they've conducted have come back negative.
I don't want to lose the ability. I'm okay. Sorry.
It's all right. It's okay.
To hear the silence mm-hmm. and to hear the wind
right.
and to hear birds sing.
At this point in the session, it's time for John to move Joe and Kathy into the suggestible state we call hypnosis. It is in this accelerated learning state where he will help them take the information he has provided them consciously into a deeper emotional or subconscious level of learning.
So I want you to look down at your hand here. I know you don't have your glasses on, but just as clear as you can. Mm-hmm. And then allow your eyes to close. Now with your eyes closed, I'd like you to nod your head if you can bring that picture of your hand into your mind. Okay. Now I'd like you to focus into your breathing. And notice that as you focus on it, the breathing will change. Maybe a little deeper, right?
Yes.
Good. And also your eyes, there's a little flutter, a little up and down movement. If you can feel that, nod your head.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then focus into your mouth for a moment. You'll notice a tendency to want to swallow. That's very normal. I just want you to become aware of that. And then move your attention down into your left arm and your left hand.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just focus on your left elbow pressing downward. And I wonder if you might imagine that we were filling your hand with helium, what that might feel like. And of course, we're using your imagination here and asking you to create a sensation. And so the left hand becomes lighter and lighter. And all we're doing now is simply asking your mind and your body to connect and create this change. Rising and lifting now. Upwards and inwards. Higher and higher. Just going to begin this process to allow yourself to move into the hypnotic state. And now this deep sleep now. Now just think about the words deep sleep. Now isn't it interesting, you're not really asleep, but the idea of deep sleep is very positive, and the idea of letting go and of moving into a calm, comfortable place. Closer and closer. Closer and closer, that's right. Closer and closer. Closer and closer. Now this deep sleep. Now we're just going to move back into your breath for a moment. Your eyes are closed. You're focusing on my voice. You're allowing me to guide you. And we're going to draw upon this imaginative part of your mind. And I'm going to ask you to take a little journey with me. And I want you to think about a beautiful place in the forest. And we want to make this a very rich experience. So it's not only the way it looks, it's also the way it smells there. I wonder if there's a certain fragrance or a certain smell in the air there that's very pleasing to you. And think about the sounds that would be pleasing there. And as you think about those sounds, and you can remember them even a bit, you lift that finger again. And so now the sounds, the smells, the images, Bring those together all at the same time if you can, or as much as you can. Again, when I count backwards from 5 down to 0, this arm is going to feel the emotion moving into it. It will become more stiff and rigid. And then we're going to release it. So at 5, now find it and begin to put it in the arm. Put it in the arm now. 4. You don't need it anymore. 3. Put the emotion in the arm now. 2. Just put it there. 1. And at 0, let it move into the arm now. You don't need it anymore. There it is. And when you're ready to release it, when you know it's time, you're going to nod your head again. Because it's not helping you. You don't need to hold it anymore.
It hurts.
Give yourself permission to release it. There it is. Let it go. That's it. You don't need it anymore. You're going to let it go. Let it go. Let it go. It's okay. Just let it go. You're all right. And let it go. Letting it go. Take a deep breath. Release it. Let it go. There it goes. You're emptying it now. You're letting it go. We're breaking that cycle. Empty it. There it goes. Let it go. You're letting it out now. I was very happy to see this emotional reaction in Kathy, because this was an expression of the emotional pressure and tension that Kathy had been carrying for quite some time. And where there was tension, you find relaxation. And where there was fear, you find neutrality. And where there was distortion, you now find truth. And you're accepting that. This is the beginning of the change now. Your eyes begin to open now. Wide awake. Eyes are opening. It takes a moment. It's okay. Wide awake now. There it is, the little grin. Nice. And 5. Eyes are open, wide awake. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
What John has done is provided me with a new model which to understand tinnitus. A model that allows me to get into a vehicle of change. And not just realizing it intellectually that I must change, because I've realized that for a long time. But I feel optimistic and hopeful that I have found a vehicle with the wheels on that will allow me to travel from point A to point B being where I need to be.
I experienced a dawning understanding of my condition. The first session was amazing. It's really amazing.
My daughter was showing some, manifesting some behavioral issues.
My business went bust. I've become small.
Hey.
We both had the chance to hear their responses.
Right.
Well, I had just this aha moment, and that's when you asked them, what was going on in your life, any emotional stress,
right,
when it started? And both of them,
right,
it was like, bang, it's like the whole thing just opened up right there, like this, like the skies opened and the light shone down and it was clear.
Yeah, and the interesting thing is how they don't have any awareness of that coming in. Joe, you know, not that much going on or whatever he said in the beginning, and then it went from that to there was a perfect storm.
Yeah.
You know, it's a huge...
I mean, the entire problem,
yeah,
changes in that instant, in that exact moment.
Yeah.
And then from there, it's sort of the follow through now.
Right.
That onset, the million-dollar question. People don't recognize the connection between emotions and their physical bodies.
That's right.
And you know, and I think it's our culture, John, that we've never been taught to make that leap. No one's ever put that connection together for us. Both of these people have been through a lot of previous treatment.
Oh.
Nobody asked them, what was going on in your life right before this started? Have you had any stress, any trauma, any changes? What's your next step?
Reinforcing what we started will be the plan. So I don't know exactly, other than I know we're going to reinforce new coping skills, understand that this is a condition that occurred over time and that we're going to unwind it over some period of time and set reasonable expectations in that regard. Make the recording. In this case, probably tonight, both of them will get the recording.
All right, let's have a successful session. All right. At this point in the process, it's up to John to continue to use the suggestible state of hypnosis to deliver Joe and Kathy positive thoughts, feelings, and ideas until they become an automatic reaction to the sound in their heads.
And in the presence of all those positive influences, what do we begin to feel? More calm or more relaxed? You'll ask yourself that question. And don't be surprised if you find those wonderful, joyful dreams reemerging. And don't be surprised if you find when you hear the sound and you breathe the breath and you exhale the pressure that the smile wants to come back again. And when you smile, it's very easy to feel comfort. Let that truth come to you. Let that healing truth come to you. When that sound comes into your mind, you remember what it is that you want to do, to see it and feel it. And as you look into your heart, in the warmth, in the relaxation, in the calm, imagine your heart begins to radiate like the sun, turning down the lack of understanding and turning up the understanding, turning up the calming and the coping, and turning up your ability to engage in your life. And you find the smiles coming to you more easily and without thought. They just kind of find their way into your day.
Working in the medical field, I am so grateful for Joe and Kathy for volunteering. Before this, I had no idea how devastating tinnitus can be.
Even though I'm a student here, it still surprises me to see just how many of the things we assume are physical are really a manifestation of our emotions.
On the surface, the hypnotic suggestion seems so simple, but the impact that it's having is really impressive.
The clouds are clearing, the sun is rising, the creativity is flowing, and you are accepting it. And part of taking ownership is taking responsibility for your essence, the essence of your life, how you're going to experience it, how you're going to interact with others. Recognize your trajectory in life and know that this is what you're creating.
It's fascinating to me to see Joe and Kathy transforming into a more comfortable state.
You see the wonderful warmth, the loving inner voice and feeling, the positive connections you're making with others around you, a life that is blooming, the way the flowers bloom in the sunlight.
You can really see the cumulative effect of the suggestions beginning to take place.
And when you think of that idea of unwinding, you're unwinding into the opposite of pressure. Now the dreams continue to be a wonderful time in which you're venting and releasing any stress or pressures of the day or from the past. And the pressures you carried on your shoulders are beginning to evaporate away now. Just let that go. And you understand that that sound that has been with you but has changed in the way that you relate to it. And realizing that you like yourself more because you're allowing yourself to be. And so you're setting an intention in your mind as we begin, and you're saying to yourself, my voice is important, and I choose to be kind, gentle, loving, and respectful.
It was so inspirational to watch Joe and Kathy's transformation, and I am really excited to be learning to do this work.
And recognizing the value of not only your intellectual mind, because you have a very well-developed intellect, but also finding the value of the emotional center. And you are claiming that voice, you're claiming that respect, you're claiming that love, and you are living it now. And at five, your eyes are open, positive, calm, comfortable, and non-suggestible to any negativity from yourself or others. And wide awake now. Good.
Thank you, John.
It's been a pleasure. And the inner voice, kind and calm and loving and nurturing. And in a very real way, you are healing yourself from the inside. And at five, your eyes are opening, wide awake, light, bright, positive, calm, non-suggestible to any negativity, and wide awake now. All right, so we'll be talking.
Thank you very much.
It's been great working with you.
Thank you all.
Anytime I can assist someone out of that level of discomfort and into an active, healthy life, it makes me really appreciate what it means to be a hypnotherapist.
Before the sessions, I was panic-stricken. I was out of control. I was filled with fear and I couldn't sleep. I would lie in my bed so tense and so afraid. But through this therapy, I've learned what it is and I feel more in control, and that has really given me my life back.
My family's seeing some changes. I used to be much more detached. I'm much more interactive with my family now. I'm much more present. Whereas before, I would be brooding over my situation and kind of letting life slide by.
Anybody who knows me knows that I'm a nature girl. I love trees and the soil and the birds. So now, when I hike, or even at home, when I can hear the subtle noises of birds and the wind, I feel connected again to the world that's really important to me. And that helps me to calm down, and it helps me to be at one with myself.
Sleeping has always been challenging to me, especially with the onset of this condition. It seemed to really impinge on my sleep. As of late, though, my sleep has been getting much better. I'm getting better quality sleep because I feel better in the morning, something that I wasn't experiencing previously.
One of the things I realized as I was going through the classes is that there are other people out there that are suffering, and there's no medical help. They don't know what's going on, and they walk through their lives with the sound in their head. I have benefited so much from this, and it's opened my life up so much.
Well, my experience with HMI and the therapy sessions I went with John has helped me in my quality of life. I feel more whole as a result. I feel empowered. I feel so much better about how I am experiencing the rest of my life right now, other aspects of my life, that having this condition is only a minor distraction or a nuisance at times. What I found most gratifying was that I felt very thankful for being able to break away from the grip of my condition.
So if anyone is wondering if this, if hypnotherapy, if John Melton or HMI can help them, they will give you hope because they gave me hope.
Given my circumstances and my previous experience with some of the other medical professionals, I was up against the wall. What I found out was that, at least for me, hypnotherapy did work. I can go now hours on end and completely be unaware that I have this condition. What it means to me, it means being able to live life, a quality of life that I hadn't experienced in a very long time.
Well, it appears we have achieved the two outcomes we were looking for. Our clients, Joe and Kathy, discovered how the power of their own mind could provide them the relief that traditional medicine could not. And our students and you got a greater understanding of how hypnotherapy can be a powerful resource to improve our lives. But it does beg the question, if hypnosis and the power of the subconscious mind can naturally and easily help Joe and Kathy overcome a condition that had been plaguing them for years, what else can it do? We hope to answer that question and more in the next episode of Hypnotized.
Take the time to let it air in. In a moment you will feel the land. Just let it in. Just let it in. Just let it in. Just let it in. Just breathe. Creeping up a personality exchange. Ending my day.